lifted me from the miry clay. Almighty, forever, I will never be the same, 'cause you came here from the everlasting to the world we live. The Father's only Son, Savior, Redeemer, lifted me from the miry clay. Almighty, forever, I will never be the same, 'cause you came here from the everlasting to the world we live. The Father's only Son,
everybody. Welcome everybody this morning. Welcome to those who are visiting. Welcome to everybody watching online at home. Welcome to everybody else who's here. We're glad to be able to come together this morning to be able to come and worship Jesus. Jeff was sharing earlier with the worship team. We prayed before the service and he just shared a verse from 2 Corinthians and just about putting God first, that we come. We put God first in all of our lives. We come here this morning and we put away our concerns. We put away our worries. We put away the things that are dragging our focus away from Him. And we come here and we put Him first and we worship Him for who He is. And so I just encourage you with that this morning. Encourage you with that this morning, not just in this worship service, not just for this time, but that's the way we live our lives. And so, we live putting Him first in everything. Couple of announcements. So the youth group is going to be going to Summit Trampoline Park this afternoon. I think everybody should be aware of that, but if you're not, you can talk to Stephen after we're done here and get more details, or if you're watching at home, you can call Stephen for more details. That's, I think, the only thing, that the announcement that we have for right now. So let's pray, and we'll continue in our singing. God, we thank you for your love for us, God. God, we thank you for all that you've done for us. And God, we pray that our response would not to be to put ourselves at the center, but to put you at the center, that you would come first in our lives. You would come first in all that we do. God, I pray that whatever is taking that place of you in our lives, whether it's something of sins, whether it's a good thing that we've made an idol out of, or whatever it is, God, that we would push those things to the side. Whatever concerns or cares that we have, we push those to the side. We would make you first here in this time that we have together this morning. And that from that, we would continue to make you first. That you would be first in all that we do. That we would take time for you each day. And that we would just be blessed in knowing you more and more. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Stand with us as we continue to worship the Lord this morning.
darkest night, you are closer like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend. I have lived in the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Yes, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. So good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Yes, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, surrendered now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after. Surrender now, I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I sing of the goodness of God. Yes, I will sing of the goodness of God. Yes, I will sing of the goodness of God. You are here. darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you, I worship you. You are here, mending every heart. I worship you, I worship you. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Yes, that is who you are. That is who you are. Yes, that is who you are. That is who you are. Yes, that is who you are. 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 Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Yes, that is who you are.
just as we are singing and singing about the goodness of God, just as the instruments you just keep playing, and just from your seats, you know, sometimes we take turns or let people just praise out, but just everybody, just as the Spirit leads, just as the instruments praise, just sing of God's goodness, pray about His goodness, think of His goodness in your life, and let's just take a few moments and just personally just reflect on the goodness of God as the instruments continue to play. God, we thank You for Your goodness. For all the ways that we have seen Your goodness displayed in our lives, in our world. God, it's easy to become focused on the negative. God, to focus on the things that are wrong in our lives, to focus on the things that are wrong in our world. But may we as Your people never fail to see Your goodness even in the midst of that. And may we know the fullness of Your goodness, that You came to fix what's wrong in our world. You came to fix what's wrong in our lives. You sent Jesus, Your Son, to die to make this world right. And that we see Your goodness on display in that as well. And so may we as Your people praise Your goodness in all the good that we see, and even in the evil that we see, may we praise Your goodness that You have a plan to fix it. We thank You for Your goodness, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Paula asked if she could come up and share. If you're not aware, Mike's sister-in-law, Linda, passed away recently. She just wanted to say a few words about that. So,
did any of you know Linda? Or
you can talk into the mic.
Yes. Did anyone know our sister-in-law, Linda Smith? Yeah, well, she was a few years older than Mike and I, and from Canada. And Mike's brother Jim died when he was 58, like their dad at 58, of cancer. And so Linda just lived two blocks over here, and she'd gotten to a point where she was pretty, had a lot of things not working with her, not well, and with COPD. And so one of the things is that he was a fireman, and anyway, he and Mike were a lot alike and really a kick. We have a picture of them with both their perms on their hair, and they're pulling like they're trying to pull apart like Velcro or something. But anyway, the thing is that they went to church at one point earlier on, and then they came here while he was very ill, and they liked it, and Ruichi visited him a lot, and then this is a memory that I have is, so somebody was in need of prayer, so our brother-in-law, who was kind of yellow from, you know, chemo and all that stuff, so anyone who wanted to lay hands on and pray, well, he hadn't done that, you know, that hadn't been part of his life, but I just always remember him just getting up, going over and joining in and laying hands on and praying for whoever it was that was in need. And my sister-in-law was always a prayer person, and so they knew the Lord. And then what happened toward the end. This is, I'm saying this because this is, you know, we talk about all this stuff, but what is it, how does it really come out in our daily life, our relationship with God, and what happens? And so toward the end, well, we didn't go see her as much as I think we should have, but when we were really prompted, we did. So this last time was, she died about 2 weeks ago, so about 4 days before that, I just felt like the Lord really was telling me to go, and I wasn't exactly up for it at the time. So I was kind of not going, but then I took a nap and I got up and I said, Mike, do you want to go with me? And he said, yeah. So we went over and she was just more cheerful and fun. And she had a lady that was coming to take care of her some hours each day or part of the time and really appreciated it. The lady took her for rides and stuff. And so the minute we got in there, we knew that it was just a fun time to see her and it was the right time, you know. And so then she has a daughter, Shannon, who teaches PE in the primary school, and then her son, Jay, was a fireman. And so anyway, the last thing she said to us was, I just want to go see Jim. So it was the point, she really found it hard for 20 years or whatever it was without him. Just so lonely. And the groups of friends that they usually got together with, well, they always had their spouse, you know, and there she was without. And I feel like that she's with the Lord. And so that's one of the things, too, is how do we think of that towards, she felt she would go right to be with the Lord. And that's, we like to think that, and I'm not sure exactly how God's timing is, you know, how that all goes. I'd like it to be that fast, you know, that we're there with the Lord and our loved ones, but whatever it is, we know it's good. So thank you for listening.
Thanks,
Paula. Yeah, thank you, Paula. And I think that's good to remember just that prompting that we have, like to be sensitive to as the Holy Spirit leads, to follow that. And we don't know who or how we can be ministering to or what. And just, and there's different ideas about what exactly, how it all works. But I feel like what we all agree on as Christians is that when we know Jesus, we trust in him, it will be like that we'll be with him and in his presence. And so, yeah. So thank you for sharing, Paula. Let's go ahead and dismiss kids for Kids Church. So walking through 7 in the primary room. All right, so it's been a while since I've been up here. It's been a couple weeks. I don't remember the last time I didn't like preach for like 2 weeks in a row. I guess when I went to Missouri, I didn't preach for like 2 weeks in a row. But but it was weird. Like just whoops. If you want to, I did forget to say that. I guess that was Holy Spirit leading me there. If you want to give, you can give an offering in the box in the back, or send your checks in. You guys know, give online, all that stuff. All right, let's go back to this. We're going to be continuing today in the book of Hebrews, and if you haven't been with us for all this time, the book of Hebrews is a book that's about the greatness of Jesus, so many other things that we can worship, so many other things we can put in his place in our life. And 2 weeks ago, we had Stephen, preached his first sermon, and talked about the rest that is offered in Jesus, the rest that we have in God, and not just rest like that someday we'll be with him in his presence, but that we can experience his presence now, that we can experience the rest of God right now in our lives, and let us not fail to enter into that rest. And so we read that, and now I'm going to be kind of transitioning to a different section in the book of Hebrews, but it all kind of rolls together and ties together. But before we dive into actually where we're going to start today, I want to ask you guys a question. This isn't a rhetorical question. I really want you guys to give me an answer. Is if someone asked you why they should be a Christian, if someone asked you why they should be a follower of Jesus, what would you say? Yeah, Logan? You're going to be a Christian too someday. You can be a Christian right now. Logan, you can follow Jesus right now if you want to, bud. All right? Anybody else? If somebody asked you why they should be a Christian? Yeah. Dakota? So they would know more about God? Okay. Anybody else? Okay, he loves you beyond comprehension or understanding. All right, let's more answers here. Come on, people.
Eternal life.
Eternal life. We get eternal life. Yeah? Yeah, Thane? It's the best choice for us, all right? In general. And he's real, okay? I heard something back here. Is that Dan? There? Oh. Salvation? Okay. So we gain salvation? Yeah, Paula? He calls us to him. Okay, so he desires us to come to him, and we don't want to ignore his call to him. Yep. Okay, those are all great answers. I'm not going to ridicule any of those answers or anything like that. There was not a right answer, but there is an answer to this question that's going to be given right here in this part of Hebrews, and that's why I want us to kind of think about that. So let's go ahead and open up. We're going to be in Hebrews, or turn on your Bibles. Hebrews 4, verse 14. It says, "Since then we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession." So there's a lot packed into this. We'll talk about this priest stuff later, but if you remember what was going on in Hebrews right before this, so what Stephen kind of talked about, what I talked about even before that, was there was this like warning passage, like don't fall away, don't neglect to experience the fullness of salvation that Jesus has for you. Don't neglect to experience the fullness of all that God has you. Don't neglect to enter his rest. Because what was happening, we don't know a whole lot about this community that the author of Hebrews was writing to, but we know that they were falling back into their former way of Judaism. They were Jewish Christians. They were Jewish people who believed that Jesus was the Messiah, but they're falling back into their former ways of Judaism. And one of the main goals of the writer of Hebrews, he's trying to convince them, don't do that. Don't miss out on all that God has for you. And so he says, hold fast to your confession. Hold fast to your belief. This is why you should believe. And what is the reason he gives that we should believe? Is he says, because we have a great high priest, Jesus. Because of Jesus. Right? Why should we believe? Why should we become a Christian? It's not because of the things that we gain, or only because of the things we gain, or what we get, or anything like that, but it's because of Jesus, because of who Jesus is, because of the person that Jesus is. Right? As we know more about Jesus, the more we understand why we should believe in him. We believe because of the greatness of Jesus. We were designed as people to worship something, to put something of ultimate worth, of ultimate pursuit in our life. We were designed to have that in our hearts and in our minds. We are going to worship something. And what the whole book of Hebrews is about is about why Jesus is the greatest something. Jesus is greater than anything else that we can put in that place. Jesus is greater than the idols that we put in our lives of success or power or family or sports. Not even that these things are like bad things, but things that we can put in areas of idols in our life. Jesus is greater than all of those. And when we recognize who Jesus is and the greatness of Jesus, our natural response is to follow him and worship him. Now, in this passage, he does talk specifically about Jesus being the great high priest. And we're going to spend some time on that today. This whole next section of Hebrews is about what it means for Jesus to be a great high priest, what it means for him to be the greatest high priest. And especially as we move into the Easter season, we're going to be looking at Jesus as a priest and what that means. And so we're not going to look at every aspect of that today. We're going to look at a couple things here. But just in general, you know, a lot of times I think when we hear this word priest, we might have an idea of like a Catholic priest in our culture. Like that's the first thing that comes to mind is a priest is the little guy with the collar, and kind of just like a pastor, maybe another name for a pastor or anything, but that's not what they would have meant or had in mind when they had the idea of a priest. So a priest was someone who served in the temple of God in Jerusalem. And a priest would go and offer sacrifices on behalf of the people. And then specifically here, it talks about the high priest. The high priest was one man, one time a year. He would enter into the deepest parts of the temple, the holy of holies, the deepest sanctuary of God, and he would offer, he would bring blood and sprinkle blood from a sacrifice of atonement on the Ark of the Covenant and would offer that on behalf of the people to atone for their sins, to take away their sins. And so this is the image that he's bringing to mind when he's talking about Jesus as a high priest. A priest is someone who is a mediator between God and people. A priest stands between God and the people. And he says, Jesus is the great high priest. That is what he has in mind, right? It's different. Like, I'm a pastor. Like, I should be leading you. I should be teaching you. I should hopefully be loving you and helping to lead your lives in godliness, but I don't stand between you and God, right? I don't go to God on behalf of you. I don't, I preach on behalf of God, I guess, or teach on behalf of God, but I'm not doing anything on behalf of you. Like, I don't stand between you and God. The Catholic notion of priest is a little bit different, but still not that they don't stand between God and man the same way that an Old Testament priest would have done. I know that when we talk about that, I brought out the idea of blood and sacrifice, and in our modern context, it's like, what's all that about? And we're not going to get into any of that today. We will in the coming weeks. We're not going to get into any of that today. But what I do want you to think about is this idea of someone that stands between God and people. All right. So with that in mind, the writer goes on. He says, "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one in whom every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need." All right, so he's talking about what it means for Jesus to be our high priest, what it means for Jesus to stand between God and between us. And there can be an idea of a high priest that's like too high, right? A high priest that's so high above the people that he can't relate to the people, that he can't really minister to the people. And what the author of Hebrews here says is that's not who Jesus is. Jesus is able to sympathize with us because he came down as a man, because God came down as a man, he is able to sympathize with our weakness, that he has been tempted like we have been tempted. Well, you might say, well, that's not true. He hasn't been tempted every way, right? Like, Jesus was never tempted to look at porn on his computer. Jesus never had a wife, so he wasn't tempted to abuse his spouse or say belittling, hurtful things to his spouse. Like, he wasn't tempted to go on social media to build up his image and to make himself look great and maybe misrepresent and lie about himself on there, right? He wasn't tempted in all the same ways we are. But when we look at life, there's nothing new under the sun. It's the book of Ecclesiastes. There's nothing new under the sun. And so Jesus might not have been tempted to go on a computer and look at porn, but he was tempted to lust after a woman, right? To treat her like an object for his own gratification. Like, he was tempted maybe not to go on social media and lie, but he was tempted to turn eyes towards him, to make it all about him rather than point people to the Father, right? He was tempted in all the same ways. He may not have had the same circumstances, the same situations, but in every way that we are tempted, every temptation that we face, there is a way that Jesus faced that temptation as well. He can relate. He was like us. He was a priest who was able to relate to us. Right? And there's a command in this. He says, because Jesus was able to relate to us that way, let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace. I need a volunteer up here. You don't have to do anything, you just have to sit. All right, Logan, come on up. All right, so imagine yourself back in the Middle Ages in the kingdom of Loganlandia. Have a seat on your throne, King Logan. Sure, you can keep the crown. All right. So imagine that you live in Loganlandia.
It is called
Span?
Spania.
Spania. Spania. All right. There might be a trademark infringement there I'm worried about, but we'll go with that. Spania. You live in the kingdom of Spania, and you need to come and see your king. What would be a reason that you might want to be able to come and see the king if you live in Spania? And what's that? Well, tribute, to get offer tribute to the king, so to give something to the king. Okay, what else might you want to talk to the king? You want to go conquer new lands. All right. Very militaristic there, Les. All right, what else might you want to go talk to the king? You needed something, like what kind of something might you need? So maybe food, like there's something going on in your village or your area. You need food. Neighbor dispute, someone else is trying to conquer. Les lives next door to Anne, is trying to conquer her. Yeah, Leif? So you're getting attacked and you need the king to respond, right? Yeah, so all these are different reasons that we might want to see the king. Now, why would you see the king in those situations, right? So your village is starving. Why wouldn't you just, talk to your neighbor about that? Or the king can handle it. Yeah, Annika? He's in power, right? The king has the power. The king has the authority. The king is the one who has the ability to handle the situation. King Logan is the one that we need in Spania, right? All right, so what does that have to do with this passage in Hebrews? It says here that because Jesus was able to sympathize with us, that we can draw near the throne of grace, right? The other thing with Spania, what might be the difficulty with going to the king of Spania? He may not want to see us, right? The king has his power, he has his authority, but you can't just walk up to the king. Like, if you're some commoner, the king may or may not entertain you or listen to you. But what this passage in Hebrews says is that because Jesus was able to relate to us, that we, with confidence, can go before our king. We can walk up to the throne of grace and plead with our king. Jesus, in his weakness as priest, Jesus standing between us and God, gives us access to the throne of grace. And it says that we have confidence we can draw near, and we will receive, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in our time of need. We have confidence that we can become before our God. We have confidence that we can come before our king, and that he will help us in our weakness. All right, Logan, you can go back to your seat. That's all I needed you for. You did great. Good job. Everybody give Logan a hand. All right. We can talk. We can debate later the merits of theocracy, Logan. You might want to read some history. That doesn't work out so well. All right, thank you, Logan. All right, so we have access to our king. Our king allows us, our Jesus, our high priest, in coming and relating to our weakness and facing the temptation we face, gives us access to our king. And our king gives us the ability to overcome. And I think in particular in this situation where it's talking about in context of Hebrews, in context of this passage, he gives us ability, he gives us grace and mercy in times when you're facing temptation. Now, real quick, so Jesus helps us when we are tempted. Jesus helps us when we are tempted. Because Jesus faced every weakness that we can, because he gives us access to our king. When we are tempted, we don't have to hide our heads in shame, but we can say, God, please help me. Help me face this temptation. Help me overcome this temptation. Jesus, as my priest, that face this temptation. Help me in you to overcome this, to not fall, to not falter, to not stumble again. Right? And it says there's two things in this passage that it says that we have, that we receive mercy and grace. And we kind of conflate these ideas a little bit, but these are two separate things. So, and this is, kids, on your notes, it has this: mercy is when we don't receive the punishment we deserve. Right? Imagine we come before the king and we tell him we've broken the law, we've done what's not commanded, and the king has every right to punish us. But because of our priest, Jesus, we receive mercy and we don't receive the punishment that we deserve for our sin. Right? And then the other thing that says we receive is grace. And grace is kind of the opposite, flip side of the coin of mercy. The grace is when God gives us what we haven't earned. Right? The salvation, the righteousness, the new life that we have in him, the rest that we have, he shows us grace in giving us what we don't deserve. We come before our king and he doesn't punish us the way that we deserve to be punished, and instead he bestows upon us goodness and good gifts and new life and hope. And so because of our priest, we have the confidence that we are able to approach the king and receive mercy and grace from him. And that's what this whole passage is gonna elaborate on, is how that happens. What does it mean for Jesus to be our great high priest who gives us access to the king in that way? And so it says, "For every high priest chosen from among men is appointed to act on behalf of men in relation to God, to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. He can deal gently with the ignorant and the wayward, since he himself is beset with weakness. Because of this, he is obligated to offer sacrifice for his own sins, just as he does for those of the people. And no one takes this honor for himself, but only when called by God, just as Aaron was." If you're not familiar with Aaron was the first priest in the Old Testament. So when the law was given to Moses, Aaron was Moses' brother. He was the first priest. And so what the author of Hebrews is talking about here is the priestly line of all the priests that followed after Aaron. And he's saying, what made a priest in the minds of the Jewish people? What was a priest? And he talks about three different things here. So the first things he says is that Every high priest is chosen to act on behalf of men in relation to God. So kind of what he said earlier is a go-between between God and man. I need two volunteers. You just have to stand here. You don't have to do anything crazy. Dakota, I saw that hand. You can't put it back down. You went like this. All right. You don't want to do it, Dakota? All right, Megan and Ella, thank you. I'm going to need more, so you guys are all, I think I need some more people to volunteer. All right, so Megan and Ellie, you guys come stand over here. Yeah, I just need you to hold this jump rope spread apart a little bit so it's stretched out. There you go. Wow, that's a longer jump rope than I thought. All right, that'll work, though. All right, so you guys have to stand here a while, though. a priest made a connection between God and man. All right, this is the first thing that says. I was doing this so we can visualize and what does a priest do and how does Jesus fulfill that. All right, so... a priest made a connection between God and man. Then the second thing it says, he can deal ignorantly, not ignorantly, he can deal gently with the ignorant and the wayward, since he himself is beset with weakness. All right, a high priest is able to relate to the people he ministers to. A priest, this is still talking about human priests, right? The human priests, there's a connection between God and the people. The second thing is they're able to relate to people. I need two more volunteers. Tori and Annika. No, don't listen to Stephen, Megan. All right, Tori. No, don't listen to Stephen, seriously. All right, here you go. Put that on. Put that on. All right, so yeah, you guys stand together. A priest is able to relate, right? They have something in common. Like in this case, they have in common. They don't cheer for teams that would trade away Hall of Fame quarterbacks when they're in their prime. or anything like that. I actually was worried that people would catch on when I came up with, like, I really struggled with what object for this. I was like, oh, I'll do the chief thing. And then I thought, oh, he's able to deal with the ignorant and the wayward and because of their weakness. all right, so what we're supposed to keep in mind here is that the high priest helps us, a priest relates to the people they minister to. Like, they share something in common. All right, and then the last thing, any one more volunteer? All right, Heidi. As it says that no one takes this honor for themselves, but only when called by God. So Heidi, you're going to have a phone here because you are called by God. All right, so a high priest is called by God. So a high priest stands between the people, connects the people with God. A high priest relates to the people, and a high priest is called by God. All right, so now what he's going to do the rest of this passage is he's going to look at how does Jesus fulfill these three things. And as I was doing this, there's a quote from a rabbi, like a 20th century rabbi, and he's talking about the Jewish people, and he says, the Jewish people are like everyone else, but more so. And that's kind of like, I don't know if I totally understand what that means when we're talking about people, but that's what I think of about Jesus is, Jesus is like every other high priest, but more so. And that's what we're going to see as we go through this. So he starts unpacking this here. And it says, there it is. I thought I forgot the verse. There it is. All right. So Christ did not exalt himself to be made a high priest, but was appointed by him who said to him, you are my son. Today I have begotten you. As he says also in another place, you are a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. This whole Melchizedek thing, this name Melchizedek is going to be mentioned a couple times this passage. We're not going to get into that. The book of Hebrews is actually going to really dive into that in a couple chapters. We'll get into that later. Melchizedek was if you're not sure who he was, though, he was a priest that existed before the priesthood of Israel and kind of revered as the original priest. But we're not really going to dive into that so much, except for to say that the calling that Jesus had and the idea of Melchizedek was a high calling, a calling that even superseded the priesthood that was given to Moses and to Aaron, right? And so he's talking about the call that Jesus had, both as God's son and as the order of Melchizedek. And so what we see here is that Jesus is a greater high priest because of his calling. Just like the priest had a calling from God, Jesus had a calling from God that was even greater than the priestly calling. And it's interesting, the way that we have been going through the book of Hebrews, we started Hebrews a couple months ago, and you may not remember, but this verse that's quoted here, so to talk about the calling of Jesus, he quotes a couple Old Testament passages. And the first one is this, you are my son, today I've begotten you. That's from Psalm 2. And you may, if you had been reading, this book was designed not to go through over the course of months, but we're just kind of slow and we want to get everything from it. But if you had been an original person in the church that the author of Hebrews was writing to, you just picked up a scroll and they would have read the whole scroll to you all at once, and you'd have caught on that this passage that was quoted, this is the second time in Hebrews that's quoted this, you are my son. It was quoted right at the beginning of the book of Hebrews. Right when it was talking about Jesus as being greater than angels, Jesus being greater than Moses, this passage, you are my son, was quoted to show the supremacy of Jesus, the greatness of Jesus over all of those things. And so it's coming into play here to show that Jesus' calling is greater than the calling that was given to the priests of the Old Testament, greater than the calling that was given to the priests that served in Jerusalem. And then the second one he quotes here, that you're Melchizedek, like I said, it talks about the authority that he has, the originality that he has, that Jesus' calling is greater, that Jesus has a unique relationship with God that no other priest has. You know, why is it that we can approach the king with confidence? Well, going back, if you lived in the kingdom of Spania, and you knew one of King Logan's advisors, you might be more likely to get audience with the king because of the relationship that Jesus has as son, because the relationship that Jesus has called by the order of Melchizedek because of the relationship, because of who Jesus was, his calling is greater than any priest. But what's interesting about this is if you think about what's going on here, it's not just really talking about the greatness of a priest, right? The point that the author of Hebrews is making is not that the priests were called by God and so they were somehow greater, like, you know, the person who's called by God is the greatest, but he's saying they were dependent upon the call of God. They were dependent upon God working and calling them. It wasn't because of, you know, there was no qualification that you had that said, this makes you a priest. If you do this and this and this, then you become a priest. You were called by God to be a priest. You were specifically because of your family lines back in the Old Testament and everything, but you were called. There's nothing that you did, right? It's not just the greatness of Jesus, but the humility of Jesus that gives us access to God, that makes him such a great high priest, that makes his calling greater. Right? Jesus was not a priest that was self-serving his interests. Jesus was not trying to build things up for himself, but Jesus was concerned with the interests of those whom he served. All right, Heidi, you can give me the phone back and you can go sit down. So we dealt with calling. Next thing it says, though, is that, next thing it says, in the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to him who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverence. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. This little passage here, I mean, this whole passage, especially these little verses, I just feel like something you could just sit and spend, I could talk about for hours. Bad news for you guys. I'd encourage you to take some time meditating on this passage this week, reading through it slowly and just praying through it in your time with God, because there's just so much that I can't even say or get to, and especially these two verses out of all this whole passage. I was studying this week. This is what really stood out to me and everything. And so the first thing, though, is that it's a little bit tricky. Like, there's a little confusion about it, right? So it says that Jesus offered up these prayers to him who was able to save him from death, and he, the one who was able to save him from death, heard, right? So it's kind of weird. So it says, like, Jesus prayed to God who could save him from death, and God heard him. But God didn't save him from death. So how can you say that God heard him? All right, and so there's a couple different things to say this. So the first thing that we have to remember is the context of a Jewish audience. One of the biggest critiques that they'd have of the Christian message is, if Jesus the Messiah, why was he crucified on a Roman cross? Right? The Messiah should not be crucified. The Messiah is supposed to conquer and lead the people and deliver the people. Why would he be the one to be crucified? I think that the point he's making is not that God heard Jesus and so delivered him from death, but God was able to deliver Jesus from death. Like, if God wanted to, he could have delivered Jesus from death. And in a sense, he did deliver Jesus from death, because he delivered him from death in the resurrection, but he didn't deliver him from the crucifixion, right? So he was able to save him from death. It's not that God was not able to save Jesus. It's that God intentionally allowed Jesus to suffer the cross. And so in this passage, it's not talking about the prayers that Jesus offered to not die and then God heard him, right? It's saying, like, when it says, to him who was able to save him from death, who is that? Who is the one who could save Jesus from death? God, right? So another way you say this, Jesus offered up prayers to God and he was heard. Is that true? Yeah, Jesus offered up prayers to God and he was heard. Now, the way he words it, like, has all this stuff that makes us, that kind of talks about God's intentionality in allowing Jesus to suffer. But Jesus offered up prayers to God and he was heard. And it says and it's important to note that he was heard, because throughout Scripture, even if you look at the original priests, like we talked about Aaron being the original priest, Aaron's sons offer up sacrifices. They don't do it the way that they're commanded, and they die. They're killed, right? And so people would say, wait, if Jesus is a high priest, did he not offer things rightly? Did he not offer sacrifice rightly? Was he killed because he offered wrongly? And it's no, it's not that. He was heard. He offered to God, and he was heard. God responded to his offering. And so what is it that he offered? And this is where this passage really stood out to me, is what is it that Jesus sacrificed? And it's very intentional here when it says Jesus offered up prayers and supplications. The word for offered here is the word that talks about a priest in the temple offering sacrifices, right? Jesus' sacrifice that he gave up was his prayers and supplication with loud cries and tears, and then later in this passage, the obedience through what he suffered. Jesus offered a greater sacrifice than what any priest had before. Jesus is a greater high priest because of what he sacrificed. He entered into our world fully. He entered into our humanity fully. I've shared this before, but one of the greatest things that I think God has taught me through the process of being a foster parent is just what it means to willfully enter into the sin and pain of someone else's life. Now, I don't say this self-righteously, like I have so much pain that I've caused, so much sin that I've done, so I don't say this in any self-righteous way, but in a sense, you know, when I sin and I bring pain into the world, like it's with people that I have relationship with, it's in my little sphere, my little circle, right? People in my sphere and circle have sinned against me, and that hurts and that stinks, like, and everything. But when we entered into foster care, what we've done is we've said, you know, foster care is always born out of sin, right? It's not like the kids have done anything wrong, but the parents, there's always a place of sin. And this isn't to be judgmental again. Once again, like, I'm not saying this anyway self-righteously. Like, I have sin in my life that needs to be dealt with just the same way they do. But I have chosen, Ann and I, and through foster parenting, have chosen to enter into that world. And we, because of the sin of someone else, because of the choices of someone else, we have felt hurt and pain and tears. We have experienced and shared and participated in their sin knowingly and willingly. And so once again, I don't say it self-righteously, but I say that what God has taught me through that is what it meant for Jesus to then enter into my sin. For Jesus to enter into my world, to experience that pain and suffering because of the choices I've made, because of the wrong things I've done, freely choosing to do that. Right, it's one thing to be in a situation, to have sin in your life from the people around you and experience pain and hurt from that. It's another to say, I am willfully going to choose to go into that. And that is what Jesus did for us. He didn't just enter into our world of sin. He didn't just enter into our sphere and experience it. But elsewhere, 1 Peter says, he himself bore our sins on his body. You know, I said earlier that Jesus, you know, was never tempted to look at porn on the internet. But when I've looked at porn on the internet, the pain and the guilt and the shame that I have, the hurt that I've caused, even not knowing of whoever's exploited for that, Jesus bore that and felt that pain of my sin. Right? When I have chosen to lie to people, when I've chosen to defraud people, when I've broken trust with people because I'm just wanting to build myself up or protect myself or make myself not have to suffer consequences, Jesus bore that sin. That pain that I caused, that fracture in the relationship that I caused, Jesus felt that. He bore my sin. He doesn't just know what it's like to feel tempted to lust after someone. He doesn't just know what it's like to feel tempted to lie to someone. You know, like, we could say, well, how can he really relate to us? Like, he has the advantage of being God, and so he was able to resist that temptation. But he actually, I think, knows the effects of my sin. He knows the weight of my sin. He knows the pain of my sin more acutely even than I do. He relates to us more than any other priest ever could. He is able to identify with me because he feels the pain and the hurt and the guilt from what I have done. And he's able to release that from me so that I'm able to approach the throne of grace and receive mercy. And what I loved about this passage is what it said about Jesus there, that it's with loud cries and tears, that he offered these prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears. And I shared the analogy of us entering into the world of someone else where we experience their sin and pain, and there's been tears and loud cries that have come with that. Jesus bore my sin. And it was painful, and it brought tears, and it brought anguish and loud cries, and he bore it anyway. You girls can go sit down. You can try to, we'll make you take your shirts off up here. Sit, just, you can give them to me later. If you can get it off, okay, that's fine. So he's able to relate. Thanks, Annika. He's able to relate to us in a way that no high priest ever was. And then the last thing it says is, being made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation to all who obey him, being designated by God a high priest after the order of Melchizedek. So once again, talking about the Melchizedek thing, we'll get into that more later. But he's a great high priest because he accomplished our salvation. Jesus is a greater high priest because of what he accomplished. He saved us. He saved us from our sin. He saved us from the death that we should have. He saved us from the separation from God that we've experienced and would experience even fuller at the judgment of all things. He saved us from all of that. I showed you that verse in 1 Peter earlier that said he himself bore our sins on his body on the tree. The rest of the verse, I didn't get my slides, I'm sorry, but the rest of the verse says, himself bore sins on his body on the tree that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds, we have been healed. What Jesus accomplished on the cross, what Jesus accomplished as our high priest was that he took that distance between us and girls just come together. Is he brought us together. Yeah, give a hug. That's sweet. You guys can go sit down. Thank you. Right? He accomplished something greater. He didn't just, as you know, the high priest did, come to take away the sins of the people or give the symbol of God taking away the sins of the people. He actually brought us near to God. That sin that separated us, that made us unrighteous, that made us worthy of God's judgment, he bore that on himself, so that we could approach the throne of grace with confidence, that we could receive God's mercy, that we could receive God's goodness. He accomplished more than any high priest ever had. He closed the gap between us. And he did so, as we just read, by being perfected through suffering. That he suffered on our behalf. For my sin, for your sin, he suffered for us so that we might approach the king with boldness and confidence that he would hear us. And so I just want the weight of all of that to hang on us a little bit as we move into our time of communion. Joe, if you could come up here and help hand out communion. And Jeff, you could come up and play. I want you to reflect and think about what it meant for Jesus to bear our sin, to to do so, so that we can have access to God. And if you're visiting with us today, communion, we don't believe is just open to people who are members of our church, but to anyone who believes in the death and the resurrection of Jesus, that Jesus has made a way for us to God. If you believe that, we invite you to take this communion with us. If you don't believe that, we ask you to let this pass you by, but you can come up and take a cup, and you can take it back to your seat. There's a little wafer and juice in there, and you can hold it, and we'll take it together in just a couple minutes. Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast our confession. Jesus, you are worthy. You are the reason that we believe. Because you were our great high priest, who entered into heaven, who came to earth, who made a way for us to come before our King. We take this bread and we say thank you that you made a way. You are the way maker, as we sang earlier. You made a way for us to come before our King. We take this bread and we say thank you. In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to him who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverence. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. God, we thank you that Jesus entered into our world, that he wasn't just tempted with every sin that we are tempted with, but he literally bore our sin upon him. That he suffered for us. And that through him we can confidently come before you, not afraid of your punishment, and confident that you will give grace to us. We thank you that he took our sin so that we might become righteous before you. We take this cup and we say thank you for the blood of Jesus and all that he bore on the cross. Just as we sang earlier, all our lives you have been faithful. All our lives you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. May we just be reminded of the goodness of God displayed in our high priest Jesus, who brought us near to you, who is called by God, who relates to us in a way that no one else ever could. And the love that was shown, and the goodness that was shown to us in him. In Jesus' name we pray.